next we have Margaret Prescod.
Thank you for inviting me and being here and speaking of movements from the bottom. That's exactly why I'm here, because in my community and communities like mine across the country, a lot of us aren't making it. There are children who are going hungry. There are women who are going to prison. Mothers, particularly Black and Latino, are the fastest growing people going to prison. I was talking to Sister Judy Vaughn of Alexandria House in Los Angeles, and she said that the new studio for single mothers is a car. Single mothers, the fastest growing population of homeless with our children in counties like Los Angeles. And that's repeated across the country. We look at child welfare. There's an epidemic of Black and brown children in particular, but also impoverished white children, babies that are being taken into foster care or put up for adoption, not because they're being abused, because the ones who are being abused a lot of the time don't get the protection that they need. We just have to look at what happened with that coach in Pennsylvania. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Clinton also brought in fast track adoption, so that when your child is taken, you go down to children's court and your child is taken and that child is 3 years and under, immediately that child is put on track for fast track adoption. And by the time the mother meets all the regulations, the classes, the whatever it is the court says that she needs, and a lot of times can't get access to it because the resources aren't there, her child is gone. Of immigrant women who are separated from their children, okay? Mother sent back to Mexico, child put up, you know, for adoption. After a while, she loses parental rights, she can't even talk to her child anymore. This is the reality of what's going on. I want to go down another layer. We hear a lot about the working poor, and I want to challenge that actually, what that definition is. But go down another layer to the throwaway people, the people whose lives are devalued so that a policeman, a white officer in Ferguson, Missouri, could shoot down Michael Brown and then his body be left in the street for hours. What does that tell you about the value of the life of young Black men? I'll tell you another horror story. Back in 1984, I founded a coalition called the Black Coalition Fighting Back Serial Murders. This was after 11 women in a 40-mile radius in South Los Angeles had already been dead before LAPD announced anything. And when I got some women together and went down to the Central Police Station, they said, "Why are you more concerned about this? He's only killing prostitutes." Could you imagine that? Like their lives had no value? That their welfare is cut, the number of welfare mothers picked up for prostitution increases. This is the layer that I'm dealing with day in and day out. And you know what? By the end of 1989, we had a count with input from the community of 90 women, 90 Black women in a 40-mile radius in South Los Angeles. And why the hell doesn't the whole world know about this? There's a man now who's been arrested, DNA, for 16 of them. Have you all ever heard of the Grim Sleeper?
Yes.
Some of you have. Where the Hillside Strangler was running around in Hollywood killing white prostitutes. I lived in New York City at the time. I knew all about it. These are Black women that are getting killed. These are what they call the crack addicts. Okay, these are the mothers who, when the riots break out, it's their children running around tearing things up. So when the organizers said, we have to look at income inequality, we have to look at poverty because it does become a security issue, let me tell you, it is beyond a security issue right now. There's a film that y'all should see. The LA Times just put it on the short list to be considered for an Academy Award. It's called Tales of the Grim Sleeper. And it tells that story. And there may be as many as 200 lives lost. There's a hierarchy of the value of human life. This is the reality of what we're dealing with. And there's a disconnect between the elected officials and the folks that I'm talking about. I do a bit more than just host Sojourner Truth on Pacifica Radio. Been down in the trenches for a long time. Been trained by people like Beulah Saunders and Johnny Tillman. Been all through it. And I want to tell you a couple of quick stories to highlight what I'm talking about. First, to just say about poverty and hunger, I won't go into it. I grew up in a little village in the global south, poverty stricken, and you know, knew what hunger was like. No child should have to be hungry, okay? Enough said on that. But as a very young woman in 1977, I think it was under Carter, the U.S. held the first U.S. conference on women mandated by Congress. Yeah, Congress mandated it. It was held in Houston, Texas. I got together, when I was an alternate delegate, but I got in from New York State. And we had to put together a coalition of grassroots women so that we could even get Beulah Saunders, Johnny Tillman, Pauline Hayes from the American Indian Movement into as official delegates, because we were up against a feminist bloc, grassroots women were. That's how we got in. A few of us got in, and the first thing we ran about doing was to throw out the welfare resolution that was on the floor, that everybody was ready to vote on, throw it out and rewrite it, and we said that mothers on welfare should have the dignity of the money they receive being called a wage.
That's right.
And you know what? The feminist lobby said, you're never getting anywhere with this.
Oh,
we made buttons. I was wearing a little apron that said, every mother is a working mother. And we had little buttons that said, every mother is a working mother. And I was with the New York State delegation at the time. Right behind us, the Mississippi delegation sat, white conservative women. And a few of them came up and said, I like your button. What's that about? And we talked about the work of mothers, the contribution of mothers, and how the poorest mothers are being penalized. And guess what? When that resolution came to the floor, the entire Mississippi delegation stood up and voted for it, and we got through, crossing the divides, finding the way. We got to find our way. I agree we need the movement on the street. A lot of us are working on the movement on the street. There are lots of movements going on the street. Just talk to the young people in Ferguson, but they don't get to hear. They don't even get on MSNBC. They don't get to talk to the Democratic Party. Instead, we hear from the same old, tired, in some ways, civil rights leadership. And those movements don't get a voice, and people get beat down and they get discouraged. But lives are depending on it. That's one story about Mississippi. Another one. I had to cover the RNC for Pacifica, the national convention. So I ran around, all of them. Rick Santorum, what's the woman's name? Ann Coulter, the whole bunch of them. I ran around, I said, did you know that mothers who stay home and raise their children under Social Security, it's called zero, they're 0 years and they get no credit. And they said, oh, that's terrible. That's discriminating against mothers. You know, that's not right. And then when I raised the whole issue of mothers on welfare, also being full-time mothers and being discriminated against, they ran in the other direction, but I had them on tape. And now this bill that was introduced, I think it was Nita Lowry in New York, about Social Security credit, for the years that we spent raising our children, that's something that could be helpful for us. We don't have to wait for the revolution to be at the gates. We need some things right now that can help us to get by. That is a bill in Congress. You can support it. That's not an abstraction. It's not a theory. It's a piece of paper. Look it up. Gwen Moore, out of Milwaukee, Wisconsin. She was a mother on welfare. She had her children taken by child welfare. She had to fight to get them back when she was a student. She has introduced the Rise Out of Poverty Act. Y'all know about the Rise Out of Poverty Act? The Rise Out of Poverty Act needs support. It's a bill in Congress. It's the first thing we have seen since welfare reform ushered in by Clinton, that we get a little something. She also has a bill that says that when your children are taken by child welfare, you should have decent legal representation. Another bill in Congress. So we're not talking about any pie in the sky here. Another example I want to give, you know, for a long time I did a lot of work in the UN. We went to the UN because Malcolm X said, go to the UN. You're like, Malcolm said, go to the UN. We go to the UN. And I've worked on women's issues, on anti-racist issues for a long time. When I was trying to move a resolution in the UN that called for the valuation of the unwaged work that women do in the home, on the land, and in the community, okay? A lot of us get confused in the liberal movements and in the left movements because we don't get it. Sojourner Truth got it. She said, when woman gets her rights, man will be right, and then there will be peace on earth.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes. Yes.
People think that when you go for something for women, it doesn't mean anything for the men. It's a total damn lie. But the reason I mentioned, by the way, we got that resolution through, even though the U.S. opposed it, and the G8 opposed it, and little grassroots folks with no money and no funding built a global, independent of political parties, networks of 1,200 NGOs throughout the world representing millions of people, including rural women. And we went to Beijing, and Hillary Clinton headed that delegation, and we defeated the U.S. delegation, and we got that resolution through. And it is now in the Constitution of Venezuela and Bolivia and a number of other places, okay? So grassroots folks can do something. But I want to bring in race here real quick, because I know I got to wrap it up. When we were doing that work, a paper in the UK leaked a document that was an official UN thing. You know, when they calculate, when, let's say a disaster happens in the world, and they got to figure out how much money, right, and aid is given. The Independent in London leaked this article. There's something wrong with the mic, they're saying, with the sound.
It was fine.
Okay.
Yeah, his name is Mike, by the way.
Mike.
Okay. We're getting complaints.
That said, the life of one person in the global south, no, the life of 14 people in the global south is the value of the life of one person in the global north. What a piece of racism. But that's not just true north-south. That's right here in these United States. And that's why all those women are killed in South LA. The police didn't give a damn. And all of y'all don't know about it. And it's not on the national news each and every night. Because there is that valuation of human life. And if you look at the Democratic Party and at the electorate, the most loyal electorate the Democratic Party has are black folks. Excuse me, am I lying about that?
No.
We don't get confused. As Dr. Gerald Horn says frequently on my round table, black folks don't start voting against our own self-interest. You know, we're also, oh, white working class people, they're confused. They, you know, vote against their own self-interest. They just don't understand. They go vote Republican. Black folks don't do that. We need to think about that. Okay, and we need to think about what's happening within our own communities and what does race have to do with it. You know, people, President Obama can be criticized for a whole lot of things. I don't even have the time. It would take a few hours to run that down. But a lot of those Democrats that ran from him, they ran from him for the wrong damn reasons,
yes,
okay?
Yes.
And I truly believe race has something to do with it. Don't tell me it did not. We have to be able to criticize him and at the same time say we're not going to put up with this racism either. And if you look at the propositions, the progressive propositions, minimum wage passing in 5 red states, the progressive propositions that got through, at the same time people are voting in Republicans, something is happening. Okay, there is room for a more progressive agenda that is practical for people. So when the Democratic Party continues to shift to the right and run after some white votes that not even gonna vote for them any damn how, especially in the South. And then they're going to wonder why the black youth didn't come out and vote. Well, where the black folks come out and vote? We need to see something. We need to see what you stand for.
That's right.
We need to see if you're going to support the Rise Out of Poverty Act, Nina Lowry's Act. We're about to issue an international petition called A Living Wage. Where is it? Invest in caring for people and the planet, a living wage for mothers and other caregivers. You see, that's how we began our UN campaign. That back then we said women count women's work. We've stepped it up a notch. We're now talking about a living wage. What about supporting payment for relative caregivers? All those veterans that are taking care of the children, all the grandmothers that have to quit their jobs, all the mothers that have to quit their jobs because they're trying to raise their babies as well as take care of their elderly ones. Why shouldn't they be getting some support? You see, it's how you put it together. I debated Phyllis Schlafly, did a series debating her on CBS, and then they did a poll. She lost the poll. It's not hopeless. Okay? So I've got the wrap-up sign here. I have some statistics to give you. I'm not even going to go there because you all know what it is. The question is, what can be done about it? And I put forward a few things that can be done about it. The last thing I also want to say is that when you see grassroots folks trying to do something, trying to find their voice, help, please, to get a platform. Elizabeth Warren just got elected to leadership. Is she gonna hear our voice? Or is she gonna hear the same old voices? We need your help. You don't help us. We're dying in our communities. Our children are dying. Our lives are devalued. Every life is of value. We have to find our way towards each other. If not, ain't none of us, including the Democratic Party, gonna make it. Thank you.
All right.